All right, let's bring in our panel right now. Mike Murphy, Robin Winston, Tony Samuel, and Jennifer Wagner-Chartier. Jennifer, congratulations. I'll start with you. A lot to talk about this week. Had a lot of news at the Statehouse, and as we mentioned earlier, a lot of it had to do with some of these controversial social issues and their impact on our schools.
That is the case, and I'm guessing, though, if you went around the state and you went to kitchen tables and asked people what they're actually concerned about, you would not find them talking about K-12 curricula. They're probably not talking about transgender athletes in K-12 or any of the other things that the General Assembly seems to have prioritized this session. I think you'd find them talking about jobs in the economy, COVID, our recovery, and how they can improve lives for their families. And there's just a huge disconnect between what's happening at the Statehouse and what's happening around the kitchen tables.
Let's bring in former state lawmaker Mike Murphy. And Mike, there certainly are a number of other bills that we've mentioned here in recent weeks that relate to the economy, tax cuts among them. But some of these divisive or controversial issues do tend to dominate the conversation at the Statehouse, especially in a short session this year.
Well, they do. And I think our good friend Abdul said it most presciently a couple weeks ago. You got to remember, this is the first half of the session. It's the positioning half. And the deadline for filing for office is February 4th. And so people are trying to act very, especially strong for their base so they don't get a primary opponent. So let's wait till next week and see what happens. But to get to Jennifer's point about what people are talking about, the Hoosiers I talk to every day are really most worried about the Biden inflation that's happened in the past year. That's what's really damaging the economic prospects for Hoosiers.
Robin, your response to that, as many of these issues move along at the state level, as Mike just mentioned, economically and politically, the president struggling here in recent months in terms of his approval rating.
Well, his approval rating in the most recent poll is pretty high that I read this morning. Also, our unemployment is like 2.7%, lowest numbers that we've had in decades. So our economy, people are going back to work in spite of COVID, in spite of all the things that we're dealing with. In the Statehouse, you know, Mike is right. Everybody got the Glenn Youngkin memo about Virginia and how to win, and they're trying to replicate it here. But we'll see what happens after the filing deadline, after we see who they have as opponents. And also, some of the state senators are not actually in favor of some of the efforts made by the House. So we'll see how this all comes out.
All right, we'll see what happens. Let's talk about the Supreme Court here. Tony, we heard from Senator Young earlier. No doubt Republicans and Democrats will look to make the court something of a galvanizing issue this midterm election year.
Well, I think the liberal Biden administration, the liberal progressives that are controlling the administration have done their part there. They forced out Justice Breyer. The news came without his statement on it. And that's being done so they can, politicize this process. I'd like to go back because I was prepared to talk about the other issues. There's a Marxist agenda that's sweeping or trying to sweep across this country. And as far as kitchen table issues, people are talking about how crazy everything is with inflation, like Mike said, with what's happening at the border, with crime, with the weakness in our foreign policy following the Afghanistan debacle of the withdrawal. And you're seeing that in state houses played out now with CRT, critical race theory, and other issues. And Republicans are standing up, as well they should be, to this political ideology that is spreading, and it is spreading not in every school and not in every classroom, but there are very progressive teachers following a Marxist ideology that is trying to influence, that are trying to influence our kids. And that's wrong, and that's why parents are standing up, and that's why you see this not just in Indiana, but across the country.
Where does all of that put us here in this midterm election year, Jennifer? We mentioned the Supreme Court. Obviously, this is a year where no doubt the court's upcoming ruling on abortion will also be pivotal in so many respects.
It will be, but I think, despite Tony's blustering there, we're still going to have only three liberals on the court. So whatever happens, whether, Breyer is a part of this opinion that is likely to come out over the summer or not, there's still six conservatives and three liberals. So I think whatever's going to happen there may actually not have anything to do in reality with who gets picked for the court. Of course, reality and politics are often very, very far apart, and this is a midterm year. So I expect to see lots of bluster about abortion and you know, CRT, which is not actually being taught in our classrooms, but I love that the right wing has made it a bogeyman. I think none of this is going to go away. It's going to be a really divisive year.
And Mike, on this point of abortion in the court, we saw a number of pro-life rallies over this last weekend, then again Monday at the Statehouse. Does this court appear poised to overturn Roe?
Well, I think there's the potential there. I mean, you know, most right-to-life folks have been working toward that since 1973. I think eventually it'll be successful. I don't know if it'll be this year or not. But I tell you, also want to remind you folks, there is an opening coming up for the state Supreme Court as well, which there's going to be at least 30 to 35 people apply for that. I hope we're able to move that to a more conservative court than it is right now. And we'll see whether the U.S. Supreme Court machinations filter down to the state Supreme Court considerations. I have no idea, but it's, you know, the state Supreme Court has a tremendous impact on our lives here in Indiana.
And speaking of the Supreme Court and the impact here on the state of Indiana, Robin, you've had some state lawmakers already saying that they could potentially be ready to act on abortion legislation here in Indiana if the court does make a significant ruling.
Well, let's not leave the U.S. Supreme Court discussion for a second. I mean, we approved Amy Barrett in less time than it takes to get your license from BMV in the mail. I mean, so we ran that through fairly quickly. We are going to put forth somebody that's going to be an outstanding jurist to be considered. And the president has every right to nominate whomever he wants, and it's up to the Senate to confirm them. Back to the Statehouse, yeah, you're going to have all kind of craziness go on between now and the final parts of this session.
Tony, back to the Supreme Court here. Could the president have a difficult time getting the Senate to confirm his choice? It is an election year. It's a 50-50 Senate. Certainly, we've seen both parties doing whatever it takes to try and block Supreme Court nominees in recent years, stemming from Mitch McConnell's choice to block Merrick Garland.
I think it depends on the qualifications. If the nominee is well qualified, then obviously that makes it easier. But if it's somebody that's strictly chosen because of their progressive leanings and progressive ideology, then you're going to see pushback, and rightly so, from Republicans. And then I think Democrats are expecting that and want that, and they're going to politicize it and use it as campaign fodder for the 22 elections in
okay.
November.
All right. Our thanks to the panel. They'll be back for winners and losers at the end of the program. Coming up next, the latest on voting legislation being debated at the Statehouse, what it could mean in a state that's already lagging behind when it comes to voter participation. Stick around. We'll be right back after this.